First of all, I would like to apologize for being late. I got stuck because of the Lufthansa strike and spent all day yesterday trying to figure out how to get to Rome. Now it worked out. So I would like to use the 10 minutes I was accorded to briefly comment on challenges that the increasing complexity of living systems as well as of our society systems bring to us. And I chose a second subtitle containing the word resilience, because I think there's a very close relationship between increasing complexity and resilience. It is interesting, even though common knowledge and barely trivial, that evolution led to an ever steady increase of complexity of living organisms and finally led to the evolution of societies, which of course are even more complex than the constituting components. It could be that increasing complexity enhances fitness, and there's obviously one reason could be that improved cognitive systems make it easier to establish realistic models of the world, and this in turn would improve coping strategies. But it is also possible that increasing complexity by itself enhances the resilience of the organisms, and probably both factors played a role. Because there are two strategies to enhance resilience or robustness. One is obviously to increase redundancy, to multiply critical components. This is what is done in many technical systems. But it's also possible to increase complexity, because once one has complex systems in the technical term, so systems constituted of components that interact with each other, a new capacity enters that we address as self-organization and self-healing. And nature makes abundant use of this strategy of self-organization and self-repair. Now, the architecture of simple cognitive systems, and there are typically, they are investigated in insects and in non-vertebrates. They consist of linear feed-forward architectures, which makes that simple organisms behave more or less in a stimulus-response manner. They respond to stimuli in an adapted way, but they have a very limited capacity to self-organize. And this motif also prevails in most of the devices that artificial intelligence has developed. It departed from the simple Hopfield nets that you may have heard of, all the way up to the deep learning systems that are now a hype in the AI world. You remember the solution of the Go game that is now has now been technically achieved. These systems, they all depend essentially on the motif shown here. There is an input layer, sensory system, sensory organs. Then there is a second layer to which information is distributed, recombined. And then finally, there's an output layer that contains the neurons, which in simple organisms produce responses. Now, this motif of feed-forward processing, of recombining inputs, is maintained also in these highly complex technical systems that we now use and address as deep learning systems. They consist of multiple layers, and the great progress that had made these systems so extremely performing is that algorithms have been developed that make it possible to adjust the coupling weights of these feed-forward connections, which are recombined in various ways at different layers, such that with many, many trial and learning steps, a particular input pattern produces the wanted output pattern. The learning algorithm that is used here is not physiological, is not applied in brains, but it is extremely performing. Now, as evolution went on, a new principle has emerged, and this is an important principle. It's a principle of reciprocal interactions or recurrency. In this case, simple feed-forward interactions are complemented by horizontal reciprocal interactions between the nodes of these complex networks. This is a new phenomenon that emerged with the development of the cerebral cortex and another structure called hippocampus in the brain, and apparently has been extremely successful. And it is implemented in all living systems at different scales. Even in very simple systems, it is used to generate homeostatic responses of the metabolic processes, for example. So what it allows for is, first of all, it develops nonlinear dynamics. It permits self-organization, it permits pattern formation, and also the storage of complex patterns. And above all, it allows to store information and to code information in a very high-dimensional dynamic space, which are great advantages for information processing, but also for maintaining homeostasis. Now, as I already mentioned, recurrence is a distinctive feature of the cerebral cortex, and it's perhaps a reason for its evolutionary success, because it's worth recalling that from the first appearance of cerebral cortex in lower vertebrates, there has been no new structure in the brain. There's just addition of more substrate. There's more and more of the same, mainly the neocortex and the cerebellum, which grows in proportion with the neocortex. So there must be a specific function that is extremely useful and can be scaled up. The motif here is, what you see here are modules of the cerebral cortex. The green triangles, they stand for the so-called pyramidal cells. And what you should pay attention to is these red wires that cross between these two columns. There's an extremely dense meshwork of reciprocal connections among those cells. And this makes apparently the great difference with respect to the algorithms that can be performed by this system as compared to the more simple systems. It's a pervasive motif. It renders the system extremely complex because of these reciprocal collaterals in between cortical modules. We have about 6 kilometers of cable in one cubic millimeter of cerebral cortex, so the amount of complexity is surprising. The same motif is maintained when it comes to interconnecting different centers of the cerebral cortex. They are also reciprocally coupled. There is very little evidence for a strict feed-forward linear transmission of information. It's always reciprocal, and the hierarchies are flat. And we have good reasons to believe that this is also the case in the human brain. There is now a human connectome project, and all evidence suggests that we are wired in exactly the same way as our next neighbors, the non-human primates. So, as I already mentioned, recurrence is also a distinct feature of cellular processes. It permits nonlinear interactions, provides large coding space, facilitates self-organization, and enhances resilience. We have just heard how many different mutations can cause a disease. On the other hand, any single mutation usually doesn't. There needs to be an interplay of many modifications at the same time. So this is just, you may have seen this in previous talks. I apologize again for not having been there. A graph representing a small network of the interaction of a selection of genes. And these network interactions, they are responsible for the differences between species. It had already been mentioned, Drosophila has more or less the same proteins than we have, but the way in which the expression of these proteins is orchestrated in cells, that depends on the coupling among those gene expressed and controlling genes. So the promoters, the enhancers, and so forth. So same motif, very similar motif as we see it in the cerebral cortex with respect to the connectivity there. Rich club networks, small world networks. The same is true for the interaction between proteins in a cell. Again, a small selection of proteins with the mind-boggling complexity of interactions. Any disturbance at any single point will cause changes in virtually the whole the dynamics of the whole system. So, as you may have guessed, recurrence is also, of course, a distinctive feature of social and economical systems. Here again, it introduces highly nonlinear dynamics. Stock market fluctuations are an indication of such dynamics. they are not predictable. And it also facilitates self-organization, as all nonlinear dynamic systems are capable of producing. But the downside is such systems are very poorly predictable because of their highly nonlinear dynamics, which jeopardizes goal-directed interventions into such systems. Also, they are virtually not controllable through top-down control, because changing individual parameters will change system properties in a non-predictable way with all likelihood. Just another graph, again similar architecture. This is a network of interacting companies, a small selection of them, of course, or the network of trading interactions, and you could have the same graphs for networks of social interactions, for example. So what are the challenges for the life sciences that result from this extreme increase of complexity of the systems we have to analyze? We have to analyze nested relations if we are to understand those systems. And this is analytically very, very difficult. And therefore, much of our techniques, they have to rely on simulations, on machine learning techniques, on meta descriptions, because we are not able to track the extremely complex interactions that evolve once more than three nodes are coupled reciprocally. Then these systems have the tendency to generate phenomena that are, of course, not deducible from properties of the components. There are emergent properties of new qualities by phase transitions of such systems. Behavior results from neuronal interactions, and in order to describe behavior, we need a different Sprachspiel, a different terminology than for the description of the neurons. And we have to somehow establish bridging theories to bring those two description systems together. Big problem in the life sciences. And then these systems, they lack predictability and controllability, as I have already mentioned. And this is a great problem for interventions in environmental conditions, but also in clinical daily life, because we always just intervene and correct a few or influence a few parameters, and it's very often difficult to find out what the long-term consequences of such interventions will be. Now, what is the challenge for societies? Again, there is the lack of predictability and controllability, and this is something we just have to live with. We have to endure it, we have to support it, there is no way to get around it, and I think this is one of the strongest arguments for humbleness. We could send this across the Atlantic in the moment, this message. I think it is, will be a challenge for the future, since we constantly change our interaction architectures, to develop interaction architectures that enhance their resilience towards deviations, towards critical states or systems collapse, or systems catastrophes, by enhancing mechanisms that assure self-organization, because self-organization, if arranged properly, if managed properly, can really lead to strong resilience and self-healing processes. But this requires systems that are distinguished by flat hierarchies. They have to have very reliable communication systems among the nodes. So lying in such systems is devastating. If neurons would not tell other nodes what they actually do, but something different, that these systems wouldn't work. And then these self-organizing systems, they all need a feedback signal that tells them whether they are in a consistent state. And also such a system would have to implement it in a self-organizing societal system if we believe in it. And I guess there will be no way around it, because our systems can no longer be controlled in a top-down fashion, as some people still believe they could do. And then another important challenge is that the rules of conduct that are required for stability, they have to be strictly followed. Think about a beehive that functions perfectly well, but simply because the nodes in this societal system, they do not lie. Bees really tell the whole hive where they found the honeypot. If they lied, the whole hive would die. If they were greedy, it wouldn't work either. If they would harvest more honey than they would need for the next winter, they would again die because the hive would heat up too much. And then turning to human societies, nodes need to be tolerant and nodes need to be, and this is very important, reliable. So what is the chance? And then I will be finished. I think we could exploit more the evidence that self-organizing systems are resilient towards disturbances and self-healing. And we could use these arguments maybe for reinforcing some aspects of secular ethics, which I think is something we need to keep in mind. Using this knowledge that we gain from science about the complexity of our environmental conditions and the difficulty of controlling the future of this planet, could probably be used to base education towards sustainability more on scientific evidence. And we had a conference here in the Academy last year on exactly that problem. There needs to be something done in order to instruct our young generation and raise them in this consciousness that, first of all, they will not be able to really control the world in a top-down fashion, and so they shouldn't believe in those who tell them these stories, but that each of them has to behave in a particular way in order for the whole system to be stable or to become stable. And then I think one could exploit more the notion that complex systems are capable of generating new qualities at a different ontological level as the description or the level at which the components exist, in order to narrow the epistemic gap between the natural sciences and humanities. And let me just give you a last slide and an example that I use in order to illustrate the analogy. On the left side, you have neuronal networks. And an emergent property of these neuronal networks and the interactions there is behavior, is also cognitive behavior. This is what, for example, makes us humans, because we have a high-level cognition, we have a theory of mind. We are cognitive agents because of the neuronal networks that we have in our body, in our brain. Now, if you take the right column, I repeated the same process. Now I just took the end product of the left column, namely human beings, cognitive agents, and coupled them in another network, a network of societal interactions. Now, what do they produce? They produce social realities. They produce belief systems, value systems, attributions to each other, which is, of course, another ontological level. It's a level of immaterial entities, which are, of course, very real because they make us build cathedrals and control our behavior to a substantial extent, but they are immaterial. They are just constructs that we have produced. And so if one looks at this graph, it sort of looks continuous, and therefore I would propose that we should slowly work on reducing this still, at least I feel it as such, a strong barrier between the humanities who describe in their language the blue cloud on the right side and the natural sciences who describe what is on the left side. And I think there is more continuum between the two sides than we currently live. That's now. I'm no longer between the lunch and you. Thank you.